bit by bit, you started to totally lose your mind and no one had any idea why. The Netflix movie, Brain on Fire, is about a 21-year-old journalist who spiralled into despair as a very strange illness wreaked havoc on her mental and physical health.
That hurts. The stomach hurts and my hands numb. I've never felt this before.
We've tested Susanna for every infectious disease. All of the results are negative.
We're gonna get to the bottom of this together.
Her EEG is completely normal. Her MRI is normal. Her neurological exam is normal. It's all normal.
Her condition continues to regress. Manic behavior, paranoia.
I'm scared.
I know she's still in there. She's just trapped.
I promise you,
I'm going to do everything I can to find you.
No, no, God, no.
Time is of the essence.
Now, that movie on Netflix was actually based on a true story. And our next guest is a Sydney teenager who, at the age of 15, started having very similar symptoms. And she's here today to tell us her incredible story. Please welcome Marina Tana to Studio 10.
Hey.
Nice to see you. You were a very healthy 15-year-old when you started having problems. Can you take us back and describe what sort of symptoms you first started having?
Everything happened quite gradually and then it was like boom. So I had a lot of headaches, tremors, and then I was collapsing out of cars. I was losing feeling in my legs, and then the hallucinations started, and that was probably one of the scariest things I've ever had to go through.
What were you seeing? What were you hallucinating about?
So mine were more specific. So they had, like, I had this somewhat demonic figure that would tell me what to do and actually command me to do certain things.
Oh, my God.
So at the beginning, it was like, that glass of water, drop it. So it dropped, it smashed, I cleaned it up. It seemed pretty tedious, and then it became like a thing that he used to control me.
Wow. Did you think you were losing, that you were losing your mind?
Oh, yeah. And at the time, I went to a school and my family didn't know what was going on. So they actually, because my mum was ill when I was younger, so she passed away when I was 10. Oh. So me being sick was really alarming for, like, my family, and they couldn't cope. So they just believed that I wasn't. So when I collapsed out of a car, it was, why are you putting it on? Don't do that.
Because you had no real support. It was anybody believing you?
No. I had this lady in my life and she went and told my school that I make up stories, and so all of my support that I should have had, I didn't.
So what's eventually, and this went on for how long?
So I probably started when I was 14. Mm-hmm. This all started happening, and then January of 2016 was when I started to get the hallucinations.
Oh, wow.
How did you finally get a diagnosis?
So I started going to Headspace because of the hallucinations.
Yep.
And the hallucinations,
which is an organisation for young people.
Yes.
Suffering from mental difficulties. Yep.
It caused me to self-harm and stuff like that. And then we did MRIs and EEGs and stuff, and it showed a pineal cyst that was 3 times larger than the average. So we went to a neurologist.
Yep.
And he did a whole lot of blood tests, and that test happened to be in it. And then we got a call, like, really late at night, and like, you have to come in. And
wow.
Once we entered the hospital, we were just swarmed with people.
Oh, wow.
Like, there were teams, like, I can't even remember how many people I saw that.
As we saw from the Netflix show, this disease, incredibly rare, virtually unknown, very difficult, if not impossible, to detect using the previous methods we had. Did they know what it was? And was it only because of the exposure that this has been given that they actually knew you had this sort of brain on fire condition?
So they didn't really know what to do.
Right.
It wasn't until I went to Westmead and saw Professor Brown that I felt like a major change was happening.
And how did you get there then? So is he the person who managed to do that test, which normally wouldn't be done?
So another neurologist at Blacktown Hospital did that test, and then I ended up going to Professor Brown after having to go into a psych ward and stuff.
Yeah, yeah, what exactly was what you were suffering? Is it an autoimmune disease where your body actually attacks your brain? What's, is there a name for your condition? Tell us a little bit about it.
So it's anti-NMDA receptor encephalitis.
Big right. word. Wow. And what does that mean exactly?
So that basically means that my white blood cells are attacking my spinal cord and my brain.
Wow. That's and funny. There's... It doesn't often show up in MRIs, it doesn't show up in blood tests. And there's a lot of confusion over whether or not this is some sort of psychosis, but it was actually... It was your body basically attacking your brain.
So what sort of... with this diagnosis, what treatment did they give you?
So when I went to Blacktown Hospital, I was on 2 or 3 days of steroids, and then I had immunoglobulin, so this infusion that I still do monthly.
Wow.
And then when I went to Westmead, I was on plasmapheresis, so I had the tube in my neck and stuff like that, yeah.
Wow. After having these months and months of madness, was it good to finally get a diagnosis and to know that you weren't going crazy?
It was. It, because of my family history and stuff, I was scared I had what my mum had, and then... and nothing was really adding up. So it was good to actually put a name to it. In terms of what they did know about it, not many people knew how to treat it, what caused, like, no one knew the details of it.
And so what happens what's the future now? Yeah, can it be managed? Can it actually be cured?
It can be managed. I'm on the monthly infusions, and then I have tablets that I take daily.
Right. And does the is the damage that it's caused, is that reversible, or is that just something you have to sort of keep it bay?
I'm unsure. I think my doctors are unsure as well. Right. I think we're just trying to get 100% recovered, or as much recovered as we can.
Despite all this, you've managed to smash some serious goals at school.
Yeah. So year 10, I barely graduated from because I had started feeling this stuff. Then year 11, I actually dropped out. And then at the end of year 11, I went to my partner's school and I emailed the principal, and just, it was an amazing atmosphere. And she goes, okay, I'll talk to the Board of Studies. And she got me into year 12. Wow. And then I felt really motivated to complete that to the best of my ability.
And how'd you go?
Ducks the score. Modest too, God.
Yeah, you are such a brave, beautiful young woman, and I can sort of see it in your eyes that it's still something that pains you and affects you even to this day. It seems like you've been through hell and back through this. Yeah.
It's going to be a fabulous future for you now. Yeah. Do you feel hopeful?
I do. I feel inspired to let other people know that if they are feeling that it... that you can come through it, that there is light at the end of the tunnel, that you can make it out.
You're so beautiful, Marianna. Thank you so much for sharing your incredible story with us. Marianna. Yeah.